Now, we're all here tonight, and for many nights to come, and for many nights previous, I mean, no matter what I say, we're all here in the context of a terrible disturbance, revolution, earthquake, trouble, which menaces us all. We're really all here tonight because in one way or another, we all realize that we, all of us, are in terrible jeopardy. We, all of us, as individuals, one by one, and the country which is called America, that great, undefined, proper noun, is now beginning to undergo a metamorphosis which may allow us and those who come after us to know what that word means. No American, until today, really has any idea of it. That's why we have something called I Am an American Day. And on that day, people who should know better get together and make out an extraordinary catalog of all the virtues mankind has ever had since we've heard of man. And that's what it means, as far as I can tell so far, to be an American. Now, of course, this extraordinary effort, how can I put this? This extraordinary effort to do two things at once, to be defined, to define oneself, and on the other hand, to reject all the terms, the human terms, by which one is actually defined, creates a kind of schizophrenia, which is again about all I know or can really testify to about what it means to be an American. Briefly, some things happened on this continent. They actually happened. For example, we killed the Indians. We really did. And those who survived are now in reservations. But you wouldn't discover this fact, by looking at a TV program or by reading most of the textbooks, which is much more sinister. That's just for example. But again, for another example, we needed cheap labor for all that cotton. And we really did. And so we got it. And decided it was happy hoeing all that cotton. Now, I never believed it, but the country did. What I really want to talk about tonight, speculate with you about tonight, is not so much the past, though I must say that probably the leitmotif of what I'm trying to say is that the people who do not know what their past is don't know what their present is, and the people of whom this is true probably have no future. I want to talk tonight about, speculate tonight about something which I arbitrarily call demoralization, which is the effect in a person of being robbed of his sense of his human value. We all have heard of Those experiments carried on in laboratories with animals such as rabbits and mice. We've all heard of Pavlov's dog. And as I understand this principle, this experiment, this series of experiments, you have a rat or a mouse or a rabbit under certain circumstances, usually in a cage, and you flash a light or you ring a bell, and the animal learns to expect. You ring a bell, and the animal expects food. And then you begin to switch the signals. You ring the bell, and instead of food, he gets a live coal. You ring the bell, and nothing happens. You ring the bell, and he's killed. You ring the bell, and somebody resembling "This Is Your Life" comes down. But after a certain number of times that one rings this bell, the animal begins not to know how to react. He no longer trusts his reflexes. And he becomes, in our quaint phrase, neurotic. Which simply means that the reflex which has been established has now been betrayed. He's been led to expect certain things at certain moments. He's been led to expect a certain gift or to have a certain need met when a certain thing happened. And then the thing happens and the need isn't met. And then you don't know where you are. And this is what I mean, essentially. It seems to me this is probably the root of what I want to describe tonight as demoralization. Now, in the case of the person, the people, who are known now as the American Negro, this principle operates, I think, I know it has operated in my own life, with terrible force. If one divests oneself for a moment of all the things we've had to learn since we were five, if one remembers that a child coming out of the womb is neither white nor black, but simply another human being who has arrived on earth, now if you're a Negro child and you're born in this country, a very brutal rupture occurs around the time of 5 or 6 or 8, but it has certainly occurred by the time you are 14. And the rupture is this. The rupture occurs at the moment you open your eyes on what I have to call now the big world, by which I mean, in this case, the American Republic. And the child is forced to realize, without knowing that he realizes it, because he is still a child, that his mother and his father, who until this terrible moment, which as I say is mainly an unremembered moment, had held up the world for him, who were his protection and his right to be in the world, are under certain limits themselves. There's some things they cannot protect him from. The child understands this and has to begin to adjust himself around it. But that's not all, because on one level, one way or another, this probably happens to all children born anywhere in the world at any time. It is the beginning, as we like to say, of consciousness. But in the case of a black child born in this country, when he opens his eyes on what we call the big world, he discovers two terrifying things. First of all, he discovers that he does not exist in it, no matter where he looks, by which I mean books, magazines, movies. There is no reflection of himself anywhere. Or, if there is something in the book, and I mean by now also textbooks, which are used in all our schools. If he looks for himself and he finds anything which looks like him, he is authoritatively assured that this is a savage or a comedian who has never contributed anything to civilization. And that's not all. Then he begins to wonder how he, who is, as somebody else put it, half the size of the rest of the world, got a nickel to his name, is going to survive this brutality. And again, according to me, that is the root, the beginning of this demoralization. Thereafter, of course, another battle begins. And the battle is involved with wresting, somehow stealing from, creating out of, so entirely hostile environment, some sense of yourself. I don't want to be rude to anybody, you know, but for example, there is on the face of it no real reason that any black cat should conk his hair. And when it's done, and then everybody has the right to do whatever they want to do. I'm not really, you know, attacking how people dress. But when it's done, it's a reflection. It has to be a reflection of the civilization in which he was born and the values of that civilization. Because he was born into a civilization which said arbitrarily and had the force to prove it that Robert Taylor by definition and Gary Cooper by definition and Eisenhower, by definition, are better men than you. And you do your best to somehow deal with this, and we all know Negroes who have done everything in their power to turn white. I don't mean people who pass. That's another story. You know? But I mean people who look like me. You know? Who never eat watermelon, you know, never go anywhere near fried chicken, are always impeccable, who cannot be seen at 4 o'clock in the morning, maybe, without a tie on, because they are respectable. And they're going to prove it. They're going to prove it to whom? This is one, only one, of the terrible things which one has got to deal with and use and transcend in order to become a man in this country. And there are two lines from a very great American poet, Tess, which have rung in my mind for years. And what she says, Marianne Moore, her poem begins, she says, "The weak overcomes its menace. The strong overcomes itself." And it goes on with three more lines, which is very short, so I'll finish it. She says, "What is there like fortitude? What sap went through that little thread to make the cherry red?" That's a great metaphor for me. And in our great trouble now, one's got to say very reckless and even sometimes very wounding things. As, for example, I don't really blame John F. Kennedy or Robert Kennedy for being the sons of their father, or for not knowing, as most white Americans do not know, what it is like to be a Negro, you know, what it is like to be, in fact, then an American. But it is a very sinister matter, a very serious matter, that one has got to, how can I put it, keep the pressure on those boys to get the revolution achieved. They're as innocent as all other white Americans. They're as innocent as Eisenhower, and a good deal better, you know. But they don't know anything about Negroes either. I think they had a Negro maid, perhaps. I'm inventing out of my long history with white liberals. But they always had a Negro maid, and they loved Billie Holiday, and they knew somebody in high school who was a runner. And and that was that. I spent a long time in their kitchens, and as we know, they never came to mind. And that is part, that may be indeed the root of, the terrible crisis. Now, we'll go back to where I was for a moment. I'm talking about this demoralization and the ways in which one, because time passes, tries to deal with it. What happened to me when I was 5, for example, whatever it was, is still one of the reasons I have nightmares when I do. And it is certainly, you know, responsible for a great many reactions which I don't really understand. If this is so, and if one carries within oneself for all these years, for all one's life, really, the seeds of one's beginnings, then the final and terrible thing about being an American Negro is the terrible way in which the objective reality corroborates your private fantasies. To overstate it a little bit, for example, I'm not certain it is possible to be black in America and really be paranoid, because they really are after you. You're not dreaming. They're after you because this is what we must know, and most of them do not know. They're after you because you were and you are, I mean, when I say you, I mean us, all black men in this country. You got here because you needed cheap labor, and you still are, we all are, a source of cheap labor. Well, let's say that's all right. What happened to white Americans was that in order to justify the need for cheap labor, they had to invent for their own peace of mind, they had to say two things at once. And you can check me out. I'm not inventing this. They said two things at once. They said, A, you were cheap labor because you were inferior. And B, you were inferior because you were a source of cheap labor. And it's a pretty unanswerable argument. It's what they call a closed circle. And that's not the worst. The white Americans had all our ancestors under their heel. And any man who's ever walked the earth for more than 16 years has some sense of what it is like. In fact, I'm sure that every man has walked the earth longer than 16 years has dreamed of absolute power. And since, contrary to the American legend, people are really private and operate on a private level, absolute power for all men has meant, among other things, what they could do with no penalties to women. And we have managed to create in this country, and everyone says, how did it happen, Mr. Baldwin? A whole race of people who are not African. I'm very dark, but I'm not dark when I'm in Africa. And as somebody put it, and as I keep saying, it is not because my grandmother raped anybody. And let us say even that that's all right, you know. Bloodshed, kidnapping, slavery, and rape are old human endeavors. But what is not all right if the person or the nation intends to survive, is that you do these things and pretend you didn't, and invent a system, a legal system, called segregation, designed according to the white Americans to keep the Negro in his place, but designed really to allow the white American to disown his sister and his daughter and his son, to make out of the things which really drive all people a travesty. And that is another kind of demoralization. That is the kind of demoralization which produces, for example, Bull Connor, who in a more enlightened age, or perhaps in another country, would be called a sadist. It produces such a man as the chief of police in Birmingham, whose name when I was there is Jamie Moore, and I guess it still is, who told me, without batting an eye, that there was no racial problem in Birmingham. Boy. Now, I don't object to the existence under heaven of people like Bull Connor and Senator Eastland and J. Edgar Hoover and Senator Russell and Senator Byrd. They have a right to live, but they have no right to their power. And the system which gives them this power is a system in great, great danger. There is no reason that such people, capable of turning hoses on children and dogs on children, should not be allowed to live, you know, to lead anonymous, everyday, just home folks, lives. Now this has had, this effort, the American effort, which is essentially an effort to deny its past. To deny its past, I mean two things by that. I mean that, for example, we were talking about myths a little while ago. I said we made a myth out of our history. And for example, most white Americans still seem to believe, in fact, as far as I know, do believe, that they all sprang from a race of freedom-loving heroes and martyrs and pilgrims. And everybody came here because they had unquenchable thirst for freedom. And we say this very seriously, as though we never heard of the history of Europe. I never heard, for example, of the potato famine in Ireland, which drove the Irish here. They wanted potatoes, not freedom. The only person who ever came here who never meant to do it is me. The European assumption was that these people were inferior. And that depends, I think, on a very simple principle. They had to be inferior. If they were not inferior, it was a crime. But as long as they didn't deserve any better, it was all right. And that is the whole basis of the whole legend of Negro inferiority. That is why there's really no reason, you know, to try to defend oneself against someone who says, you all have too much syphilis, and you didn't steal fire, you didn't invent the wheel. First of all, nobody knows who stole the fire or who got the wheel. That's another lie. And that's not the point. I don't have to have stolen the fire or have invented the wheel to have the right to walk around in my lifetime like a man. One can't defend oneself against somebody who is determined to prove to himself, not to you, but to himself, that you are inferior and want you to corroborate it. One's got to walk out of that nightmare. But the demoralization, which is now overtaken, or is about to overtake, can overtake the Western world, is seen in great relief. The end of that journey is seen in the face of Jamie Moore, for example, in Birmingham. It is seen in the faces of all the Alabama sheriffs and in most of the New York cops. They really don't know. They're not even really wicked. That would be all right, even. You can deal with a wicked man. But they really don't know. They've deluded themselves that I was happy on the levee, that all that singing and dancing, all that singing of the blues, all that teeth, you know, they thought I was happy. Now, they knew that if they had been in my place, they wouldn't have been happy. And I know they knew that. There's one thing every man, everybody, every human being knows about another human being. Every man of a bone, no matter what he does about it, knows, he recognizes, cannot help but recognize another man. He knows he's not a monkey, for example. This is a man. And men strike echoes in each other. Human beings strike echoes in each other on which they depend in order to live at all. Now, if you find yourself in a position where you must deny and make a system out of denying the manhood of another, you have simply emasculated yourself. That is one aspect of what I mean by demoralization. And I confess that it's sometimes very hard to remember when you're in the precinct basement or when you're dealing with all these people, and not only the precinct basement, when you're at a literary cocktail party. And somebody says to you, for example, if I may ramble on just a few more minutes, somebody you've known for years, you know, and someone who is, let us say, in your profession, by which I mean one of your peers, and someone who is not a racist, even, at all, has invited you for dinner at his house on Sutton Place at 8 o'clock. Dinner and cocktails and a few friends. And if you're me, you know, you're always a little late. But in any case, you've got to get a taxi to get there. And I'm sure that I'm not the only person who is aware that it is sometimes very difficult when the sun goes down to get a taxi. So you evolve all kinds of systems to beat this system. And there's always one taxi driver who has the presence of mind to lock his door from the inside, who has to stop for the light. And you get in. And it turns out you are not going tonight to 125th Street, which you don't tell him for a while. No. All you tell him is, you drive me where I'm going, or to the police station. All right, and he finally takes you to where you're going, which turns out to be Sutton Place. Whereupon he, of course, is having something resembling a stroke. Like, what are you doing there without a package? This is in 1963. So you arrive at your host, your liberal host's home, understandably a little frayed, a little tired, you know, and you're still trying to be a gentleman, you know, and you ask the cab to give you a double scotch, and he says, what's the matter, Jimmy? And you say, well, you say one of several things, and by and by I come down. And then what you're told is, my God, Jimmy, you're so bitter. And then, of course, you'd like to kill him, you know. You really do feel for a minute with friends like these, and you know the rest of the phrase, I hope, you know, who needs enemies? But he's not being wicked. He really doesn't know. And what he doesn't understand about the assumptions he betrays are that he really thinks, he really somewhere at the very bottom of his heart, stomach, must believe that because you can call a taxi and come to a certain place, everything's all right. Because that was what you wanted. And it always occurs to me that must be what he wanted. Because when I was a little boy, I never heard of certain places. They don't understand where reality is. When someone says, what does the Negro want? I'm always thrown. Because I know that I know what he wants. I know what anybody I'm dealing with wants, you know, more or less. I know that they don't want to be in jail. They don't want to be tortured. They want to raise their children. They want what everybody else wants. And someone says, what about intermarriage? What about miscegenation? You have to look at him again. He's not talking about miscegenation at all. He's talking about black men. He's talking about black men. It's not miscegenation. It was a white man doing it. It's miscegenation if I'm doing it. And that, if I may say so, says vastly more about the man who asked the question than it does about me. Now, I went to school here. I mean, when I say here now, I mean America. And it was impossible for me, when I was a school child, to understand anything about my own history, about my own past, because it wasn't in the textbook. This really means, that if my history wasn't in the textbooks, nobody else's was either. And I mean that until today. Americans don't know their history, and history is not something you study. History is something you achieve. You've got to know what happened if you intend to make another move. And Americans don't know what happened. Not yet. I beg you then to think in the same context of an extraordinary movie called The Defiant One. Two chain gang convicts, one black, one white, who were chained together so long that they begin to love each other, which is a weird and an unhistorical idea. And as you remember, at the end of the movie, Sidney finally jumps off the train because Tony can't make it, which is another weird and not quite so unhistorical idea. But there's a very important moment in that movie in which they get to a farmhouse and they meet this improbable farm wife who, of course, falls in love with Tony. Now, they've both been on the road for a long time, you know, dodging tsetse flies and things, you know. And as far as you can tell from looking at the screen, they're both men, you know. But Sydney doesn't seem to need a woman. Tony goes into the bedroom, if I remember this movie correctly. I think I remember the music. And Sidney stays in the kitchen, because he's too tired. Well, you know, luckily I didn't write that movie. But I suppose it consoled the man who wrote it, and all the white people who saw it. And only has one terrible flaw. It isn't true in any way, whatever. It isn't true about people, and it isn't true about history. Blacks and whites have been chained together in Mississippi for a very long time, and so far as I can tell, they've not yet learned to love each other. What I want is that one do two things at once. That one recognize and rejoice in and utilize the fact that one is black or beige or brown or whatever. That one is legally in this country a Negro. Okay, crazy. That one understand, profoundly understand, that I, speaking now as a Negro, I did not invent the nigger. I never needed him. It was not my trauma. I didn't suddenly wake up and say, oh my God, I'm black. I never cared until I realized how many other people cared that my nose was flat, my mouth was big, and my hair was kinky, and my skin was dark. That didn't bother me, baby, until somebody called me nigger. And then, of course, since I was born in America, I had to watch those people very carefully, and it cost me something, and it has cost us all something, and for a very long time, to step out of that standard of judgment and realize that it's their problem. They invented it. I never needed it. I always knew that I was a man. The country never did. And the cries of anguish one hears now are involved mainly with the fact that now, for the first time in our history, they are beginning to suspect that fact. That they invented the nigger because they needed him. And now they're beginning uncertainly to wonder why and what can they do about it. And of course, there ain't much time to do anything. One, I said before, that every man born knows when he meets another man. Every man born knows that. Now, if that's so, and all these crimes have been committed because you said he wasn't a man, and now by 1963, these crimes are being committed in the name of the bulk of the white population, it's a terrible crisis. Have to go back and think about it and recognize that what you are accusing this man of, like he's a rapist, he carries a knife, you know, you can't trust him, he's lazy, or conversely, he's a saint, so don't worry about him. All these things were inventions. White people invented this creation because they needed it. I'm not going to keep you much longer, but I want to spell this out a little bit, just one more time. William Faulkner, who was a very important American writer, and in six novels, a very great novelist, was yet unable to recognize that the Negroes he wrote about with such love and such affection and such warmth, like Dilsey and the Sound of the Fury, did not exist for him. And he spelled that out. In the Sound of the Fury, to put it very roughly, the decaying Southern family is saved by the stoical black maid who was called Dilsey. And what Faulkner knew about Negroes was that they existed to save him. Later on, in a novel much less important than The Sound and the Fury, in Requiem for None, he has Temple Drake. And remember, I'm speaking as a writer. So I know a little bit about what a writer is doing from the inside. He has Temple Drake and whoever her husband is, and I forget the whole terrible, ghastly family. But they have a Negro maid named Nancy, who is also a dope addict and a whore, naturally. No. And she, understanding that Temple is going bad, Temple is the wife. Temple is, I gather, a nymphomaniac. It's kind of an impenetrable book. Nancy, in order to save this family, murders the baby, which, according to the peculiar logic of this book, brings Temple to her senses. And when Nancy's about to be hanged, the judge says to her something, I forget this extraordinary exchange, but anyway, she's going to go to heaven. And the judge wants to know why she's going to go to heaven. How does she know? What are you going to do there? I think it's a line. And Nancy says, I can work. Well, no Negro domestic that I have ever met dreamed of going to heaven in order to work. But Faulkner believed it. He was unable to understand that those black people he loved so much had no descendants. And furthermore, unable to understand that Dilsey and the Sound of Fury, whoever the model for this woman was, also had a husband who couldn't get a job, probably had too many children, one of whom was certainly lynched, two of whom probably died, and the others were ruined. Negroes have always existed in the popular imagination as something white folks had to have. According to Faulkner, and until today according to most of the reports I read, my role here is to assure Mr. Charlie not only that he's, you know, God's gift to the universe, but that I like it that way. And now that party's over, and the panic's on. Now, since the panic's on, and since one is forced to try to, all of us must try to think of ourselves as responsible human beings, one has got to invest, I think, try to invest our children and anyone else we talk to with a kind of morale which the country has always denied. One has got to make it clear to your child, to your niece, to your nephew, to your brother, and to your sister, I'm speaking now as a Negro, that contrary to what the Republic says and has always said, in fact, and the record bears me out, that in order to become a man in this country, the Negroes had to do and endure and transcend incredible things. And that if you manage to get to be a man, a black man in America, you really are a man. This is not true for most white men. I hate to say it, but that's true. Again, to spell it out a little bit. During that celebrated meeting with the Attorney General, the question of Negro manhood came up. And Lorraine Hansberry said that she wasn't worried about Negro manhood on the whole, really. No. She knew where they were, and they didn't do it, no. And she knew what, and she knew the story, but, and she said they have done beautifully on the whole. They have done beautifully. But I'm very worried about the civilization which can produce those five cats standing on that Negro woman's neck in Birmingham. And I'm very worried about that civilization, too. And we can't allow it, as long as we're alive, to become academic. We can do all kinds of things, you know, but here we are. Now, what I'm pleading for tonight is this, that one never teach one's child one thing, just one thing. Make him proud that he's black. But don't... but don't tell him that he's better because he's black. I know my mother worked for white women all her life. I know her mother did. I know her grandmother was a slave. My father's mother was a slave. And when the chips are down, as I was trying to say before, when one's in trouble, you go back to that. I'm trying to say there is no reason under heaven to be ashamed of that. The auction block, the middle passage, the lash, the knife, the rope, the cotton, all the anguish, all the blood, all the terror is what we have to get us through. I did not come from Islam. Perhaps I wish I did, but I didn't. I come from a long line of people who were kidnapped out of Africa 400 years ago. It's up to me to do with it whatever I can do. But if I lie about it, if I pretend that I am something else, then I will have embarked on the same nightmare which one prays is ending now in our country. The sun never set 20 years ago on the British Empire. And now it has set forever. And the English, who took their identity from all these conquests, no longer know who they are. And England is only one example. It is true in another way in France. It is true all over Europe. This is what it means when a doctrine crumbles, and white supremacy was only a doctrine, it was never the truth. Now, my point here, we are at the threshold of a long, hot, and very dangerous summer. And what I want us to try to do is to be clear-headed about it. To really be clear-headed about it, and I mean when I say that, to recognize that, for example, though the Kennedy administration, for example, was very proud of its record and has in fact indeed done more than any other administration, it in fact has done very little and really far from enough. And the reason for that is they have yet really to understand how serious the problem is. This, I think, is a fact. They see its gravity in another way. I think they see how dangerous it is in terms of internal chaos. But they don't have any sense, as far as I can tell, of the great depth of anguish and despair and frustration and bitterness and rage in the Negro people. They really do not know, as I said before, as most white Americans do not know, what is happening on the streets of Harlem. And the whole institution called segregation has been designed to protect white people from that fact. In fact, that's what segregation means. And it has worked so well that Americans don't know now what the Negro wants. That's what they keep saying. Now, this imposes on anyone, I think, who wants to be responsible. One must then begin, I think, to try to... I walk through the streets of Harlem, and I think I know, what a terrible force, what a tremendous force is here. A tremendous force. And since I have the habits of an older brother, or since I consider myself your poet, and do not want to see any more black lives ruined in any way whatever, and although I know I will, one would like to channel it so that one can minimize the damage, the human damage. We are living through a revolution. We really are. And there's no way for that to be pretty. But I would much rather that one did concrete things, like to be reckless. If I were, really a politician, as distinguished from someone who finds himself in politics, if I had that kind of capacity, that kind of capability, what I would do in Harlem, for example, would be to organize a massive rent strike. And have nobody pay the rent. I mean it. Have nobody pay the rent. This is a ghetto. I don't care how much rent you're paying or how pretty your apartment is. This is a ghetto because you can't get out. It's important to remember this. That so far everything's been done in this country, we did for ourselves. The administration boasts of its record in Birmingham and overlooks the fact that it was in fact the Negro people of Birmingham who forced the crisis. And then the department moved in with too little, much too late. There are things, one has got to be not confused. One is attacking not the white face. One is attacking a power structure. A very complex power structure in which a great many Negroes make money too. One's got to keep the pressure on all those people in power. One's got to make somebody tell somebody one day, for example, one's got to make somebody tell me exactly why no one ever talks about Senator Eastman. Why? I would like to know why. No politician, as far as I know, said a word about Easton's telegram to Medgar Evers' widow, which, if you know anything about Mississippi, he sent a telegram to Mrs. Evers, deploring the death of Medgar. And I accuse him of being responsible for it. And I don't mean, no, he hired the assassin, and he probably doesn't own a gun at all. But I accuse him of being responsible for it because of his entire career. His entire political career made that death inevitable. All the good white people on the hill are never in the streets when the mob arrives. When the niggers burn, they don't know nothing about it. But remember what I talked to you about before, about cheap labor. And you think of the southern oligarchy and the poor, poor white who has always been assured by his masters that though he didn't have a dime, couldn't raise his children, made one penny more than me, he could never be that badly off because he wasn't black. And the poor white believed it, and the other cats got rich. When such a man as Senator Eastland sends a telegram to this widow saying, I deplore it, in a more virile nation, that action would have been condemned as obscene. I think we have the right to know why he is sacrosanct. This is still, one has got to operate on the theory that it is a free country until they prove differently, in which case, of course, well, that's another story.
There followed a question period. The first question concerned the effect of the black Muslims in America.
Well, speaking only personally, there's no way for me not to have a certain emotional, visceral response to the Muslim movement and to what Malcolm X says. It's not possible. This is because the only catalog of what I know about the Harlem streets, what I know about not only the Harlem streets, but about a Negro anywhere in this country. Most of, if I may be, well, most of the largest segment of what we will call here the Negro bourgeoisie pretends it doesn't exist, and all liberals essentially pretend it doesn't exist. And I know, for example, what it's like to try to get theft insurance in Harlem or fire insurance. And I know the bit. I know the bill. Malcolm details it. And with that, you know, God bless him. And it's his great power over his audience that he corroborates the agony, the despair, the demoralization, again, which the entire country denies. When the country begins even to suspect it exists, it says, well, wait, tomorrow will be better. And I can't tell my nephew or anybody I know that tomorrow will be better. You know, because maybe tomorrow will be better, but that's academic. And I must also say that because of the because of the fact that the bulk of the white press is really ultimately concerned with protecting the power interest. They've created a situation in which it is very frequently necessary to read the Muslim newspaper to find out what's happening among Negroes. And the white society doesn't really realize how sinister this is either. Now, and also finally, to give the whole bit, it is also true that the Muslim movement operates in effect and quite unconsciously, I think. I mean, I'm sure this isn't part of any conscious policy. But their presence operates to protect some Negroes, by which I mean the Negro cat and Negro boy and girl in Harlem, because the cops are afraid of Malcolm. Now, all that having been said, you know, if that were all there was to it, then I would obviously have to become a Muslim myself. And the only reason at bottom that I am not is because although he's added up all the figures, the sum, the figure he comes out with, is wrong. I.e., it is true that the American Negro situation is intolerable, dangerous, and disastrous, and it is true that we've been murdered here for a very long time. But it is not true that all white men are by nature evil and all black men are by nature good. That is not true. And I can't agree to that because I can't teach my child that.
The next question asked Mr. Baldwin's feelings toward America and his guess as to where the country would be in 10 or 20 years.
Actually, the answer to that question isn't up to me, you know. It's, I'm not trying to, you know, to ignore your question, you know. I was born here, so I'm very involved with it, you know, so the one has to say I love it. And anyway, I do, yes. My forefathers helped pay for it, you know. It's my country. Now, if Americans are ever able to recognize that it's my country too, which means that it is not a white country, then we have some hope. As long as Americans imagine that it is a white country, then there is no hope. So it's up to you.
What role, if any, asked the next questioner, can the Christian Church have in settling the racial problem?
Well, I'm sorry that I can't be very encouraging. That question should not have been asked of me. It should have been asked of the people who lead the church. It should have been asked of all the church members in this country who have made of the Christian Church the most segregated institution of all. That's a very large statement. You don't believe my answer. I want to assure you that I am not trying to be cynical. I am asking you to examine the record of the church you say you represent.
Mr. Baldwin was finally asked if racism were perhaps too deeply ingrained in white Americans for Negroes ever to gain full equality.
That's a loaded question. The only way I can begin to answer is to say, I hope not. I don't want to be a part. I don't want to be accepted into this society the way it is. I refuse it. The only hope we have is not that Americans arrive at what we call before the Eisenhower level, you know, but that in order for this country to be liberated, they've got to give up the nigger. Economically, they've got to let him out of the ghetto. And emotionally, they've got to accept him in themselves. Now, I'm not anxious to marry nobody, you know. And I'm not talking about that. But I'm not afraid of the man. The man's afraid of me. And until that ends, there isn't any hope, you know. But I'm not trying to, I wouldn't tell anybody I know to go to Madison Avenue and get a job in advertising. I reject the standards of this republic. The point of the revolution is to change those standards.